to do that work. I'm superior. I'm a superior class. I'm entitled to the results without any work on my behalf. I'm entitled to the results. This first phase teaching again. If you're a first phaser, not even repentant, you shouldn't be watching this because you don't understand what's being said at all. You'll twist it into, hey, I'm entitled to understand this. Therefore, whatever my understanding is, that's good enough. And then they'll demand that you accommodate to their understanding because they say, I'm entitled to have the highest understanding. And so they say, you're not entitled to have any higher understanding than I do. So whatever my understanding is, that's the highest. It's got to be, no one can be any higher than that. And of course, they're completely deluded, so they're demanding you be completely deluded. This is the entitlement complex. And this is what has been fostered in this world to an extraordinary extent. And part of the reason that some of the Tibetan teachings of the Hatha Yoga, the Dzogchen Yoga, have been accepted in the world is part of it, not all of it, some of it, because it ties into this entitlement complex. As people say, yeah, I don't need to do anything. I'm entitled to everything I want. And if people have something I want, I'm entitled to it. I don't have to do anything for it. They should give it to me, you know. And so this the idea of we don't need to do anything, Dzogchen, can feed into this entitlement complex, which is why Samaya was enforced, which is secrecy, which is why Padmasambhava, however you want to say it, the original transmitter, one of the original transmitters of Dzogchen teaching in Tibet, coming from where? Swat Valley in Afghanistan, supposedly. They don't know for sure, but that is why he said, you're not ready for this teaching. And so he wrote a lot of teachings and then buried them all over Tibet. And there were other teachers, transmission teachers, who also buried a lot of teachings, buried them somewhere, like buried treasure, like pirates buried treasure. Because they said, you're simply not ready for this teaching yet. And then this code of secrecy, I always think it's called Samaya, something like that. And they said, don't teach these teachings to ordinary people because it will foster this delusion of entitlement. And they'll start demanding that others work for them to give them this, what they think they are entitled to. And they just say, hey, I'm entitled to that. I don't have to do anything for it. So, to a certain extent, this permeated the 60s and the 70s. There was there was not really an understanding of all this transmissions that were coming out of Tibet and India, and it was overwhelming. I mean, keep in mind that what was the China? When did China come into Tibet? In the 1950 or something like that, and then the Dalai Lama made an agreement and agreed to a 17-point agreement. Then there was the uprising in 59, and a lot of Tibetans fled, and it was at 56 also. So it was basically everybody was out of there by the 60s. So that the 60s were the Tibetans had already left Tibet, you know, most of them. And then this was all like just the consciousness of the world was just being impacted by this. And India was heavily involved, and people were really involved, and this really started to permeate the world consciousness. And so the 60s and 70s was just this, all this teaching, we were flooded by this teaching. We said, what in the world is this, you know? What? Because previously they tried to keep the teaching secret and unto themselves, and understandably so in some ways, because the fourth phase teaching is not not put in the right context by those who are unrepentant, that is for sure. And so those who have an entitlement complex, picked up on all this and said, hey, you know, we don't have to do anything to be the best. We're the best. People should, you know, without any spiritual path whatsoever. Would say, what path? We don't need any path. We're entitled to the results of any path whatsoever. We're just inherently entitled to it. Again, overlooking the continuity fear problem. So they never even tackle it at all. And so this is built up. This is really the 60s and the 70s are really the root. I mean, I think that the expelling of the Tibetans in the 50s was a watershed of the history of this world. It's never been the same. Absolutely never been the same. It radically changed everything. And a lot of it has to do with people looking for entitlement because they don't realize they have this extremely bad problem. Because the Dzogchen teachings tend to say, as I'm saying, there is no problem. So I say, oh, there is no problem. But I say, wait a minute, there is no problem except the continuity problem. Okay? Except the continuity problem, which is a temporary pragmatic problem. But that one is super severe and gives rise to an entire insane asylum. See, the problem is that there's never been a problem. And we've been believing that there is for so long that the problem, the fact that there is no problem, is a problem for us. This is the thing. So there's all these people strutting around and back in the 60s and 70s and the 80s that keeps going and saying, hey, you know, I don't have any problem. I don't have any problem. I'm free. I'm liberated. And so this whole liberation, feeling of liberation, 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 liberation. Is, you know, has become, the pop liberation of everyone is completely phony. It's all this entitlement complex. This is the problem, you know, of disseminating these teachings to those who are unrepentant. So you don't get these teachings in Tibet until you've gone through tremendous, you're tremendously mature. The teachings are kept away from you, actually, until you're tremendously mature. If you want to understand modern culture, what's going on, you have to understand what happened in Tibet, Tibetan Buddhism. It's become the, you know, the darling of the world. You have to understand that's a watershed. That's a watershed, no question about it. Some have benefited from it, for sure. Maybe quite a few have benefited from it, but there's also this other situation that is really bad. You get people with severe entitlement complexes rising to positions of extreme power who feel like they're beholden to not beholden to anybody, as if they're some kind of Dalai Lama themselves, you know. They can do anything they want to. They're entitled to, they think. They're entitled to all this, you see. So this is a huge, 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 huge problem in the world. It's like the psyche of the world is, you know, came unhinged in a certain way. It always seems to be coming unhinged in one way or the other. But, and we're about to really taste the repercussions, severe repercussions of that. So, so it's not that we're entitled to anything. We are everything. We already are. We simply are. Isness is. We're entitled to no problems. More than that we never had any problems. We can't have problems. We can't solve them either, right? So those are saying, I'm entitled to solve all your problems. I'm going to do so unilaterally. I'm entitled to solve all your problems. We don't have any problems. What are you talking about? That's not religion. That's not truth. Solving all our problems, we don't have any. Nobody has ever had any problems. We're trying to have problems. We imagine ourselves to, but we don't have them. We think the brain has problems. We're not the brain. I am not the brain. I'm not the body. I'm not the brain. I'm spirit. Still as God created me to be, I'm free. Spirit as God created me. So you just let this all sink in. Don't do anything about it. This entitlement complex is incredibly tricky, and we seem unable to, like we're paralyzed, like deer in the headlights by it. Partially because we don't want to say anything. We think it's somehow linked with Tibetanism, Tibetan Buddhism, the Dalai Lama, or some of those teachings. It somehow has gotten into our blood, into our DNA, you know, into our spiritual DNA. And we don't say anything against, dare say anything against the entitlement complex. Because we think this is it. You're always wondering, maybe somebody knows something more than I do. There's some secret Tibetan rituals. No, there's nothing like that. Nothing like that whatsoever. The highest teaching is Dzogchen. The highest Dzogchen is Longchenpa. We already know how Longchenpa teaches. We already know what he says. Nothing beyond that. People are playing off this mystery of Tibet as if somehow they got it. But what they got was their ego said, hey, I can really use this to generate this entitlement complex, which says I don't have to deal with the continuity fear. I'm an exception. I'm an exemption. I'm entitled to not have to deal with that. I'm special. I shouldn't have to deal with that. Someone else needs to deal with that, not me. I'm beyond that. So all the problems of this world, is someone else supposed to deal with that? Someone else is supposed to make me happy. You know, it's like that. The world's supposed to make me happy. That's what the ego wants. So the ego has played it very skillfully. Very skillfully indeed. game is about up. We gotta make sure the game is up before they really, you know, put the full press on us. Yeah. See, what everyone wants to say is, I don't have to deal with the continuity fear. I don't want to do that. I don't have to do it. They want to believe that they can just decree that. Says, I don't have to do it. Maybe others do, but I don't have to. And then they look for some ideology that fits with that. And, you know, radical Dzogchen, to some extent, fits with that. At least it can be misinterpreted that way. People thinking there's some secret Tibetan teaching where you don't have to go through any trouble. It's instant enlightenment. And so people are kind of posing, subtly. It's subtle. This got into the consciousness, okay, especially of the Western world, but around the world, there's this subtle posing, like, hey, we can be materialistic and just do whatever we want to do. It's okay. It's totally okay. I'm aware that there's the secret teaching, this ultimate teaching where nothing we need to do to get to be enlightened. We're already enlightened. We can do whatever we want to do. And so I'm entitled to do whatever I want to do. And entitled to tell you what I want, how I want you to see me, and I'm entitled to this, entitled to this. It's a subtle thing, but it is permeated, especially the intelligentsia, academia, intelligentsia, was like the, you know, top thing to say that you know a Tibetan teacher. Then it's like, wow, what do they tell you? What do they tell? Well, they said that there's some higher teaching. Oh, wow. And then someone says, yeah, I know what the higher teaching is, but we're not supposed to say much about it. I got it, you know. Just really, really flooded in. If you're aware, as I certainly was, so, wow. Very intimidating. Because the idea was that Tibet had been, you know, sequestered from the rest of the world for so long that they had developed these, like, secret techniques nobody else knew about. And so they're just, like, way more advanced, you know, and so people are finding out about those, and then you felt like that they're one, whoever knows, they're one up on you, you're one down, you know, and you're now needing to get the secret from them. So the people are acting like, yeah, I know the secret, and if you want it, you can get it from me, but, by the way, you know, I've got some problem, you know, there, could you deal with that for me. Tell me all that. Okay, great. And so they start using this leverage, you see. So society has been leveraged in this way, very heavily leveraged. And it's like we'd say, hey, you know, those who've been boycotting truth for a long time, which are certain, there's been a big boycott of the Nazarene, Jesus the Nazarene, of his teachings. Huge boycott throughout history, especially those whose religions he replaced. The nature religions, the pagan religions, the goddess religions, all those, you know, the Romans had just, oh my God, they had so many deities they were praying to. And the ancient world had all this, of the Mediterranean area, the Near East Mediterranean, all these deities, and Christianity replaced those. And people went along with it because that was the law, etc. But most people boycotting it. pretending to go along, but they're really boycotting it. They've been boycotting it all along. So there's many, many, many people of what I call the goddess religions, especially, who've been boycotting Christianity all along. And now here they are, and now they claim, hey, you know, we're entitled. We don't have to go along with this evaporating of continuity fear. We don't have to move our comfort zone. We're entitled to. We know the secret now, and so we're beyond. We're above that. Inherently above that. Don't need to do that. We don't have that problem. But you got a lot of problems because you're not doing. You're not acting the way we want you to act. So. You can help us out by doing this and this. And so, you know, it's like they're boycotting truth. And then when you say, talk truth to them, they say, I don't understand what you're talking about. And I don't need to. See, I don't understand what you're saying, and I don't need to. I got something better. And what they glommed onto was this Dzogchen, just in a way that fit the feeling. I got something better. I don't need. You know, my boycott was legitimate, is what they're saying. No, it wasn't legitimate because you should have spent all that time moving your comfort zone, evaporating your continuity fear, so you could truly understand Dzogchen. See? So they just decided to boycott, waiting until a time when they felt that they could get all this materialistic gain. You know, they didn't want to do the hard work. They said, no, we're entitled to get all those benefits without the work. But the problem is the benefits that they see now are material benefits. They don't understand spiritual truth because they boycotted it all these millennia. So now they're saying, yeah, we're entitled to the benefits. We're entitled to the results, the good results of truth, because we're entitled to it. And what that is material possessions and comfort, control, okay, that's the rewards I think they're entitled to, and you're supposed to give it to them. The BCS, Boycotting Christ Syndrome, there's many people have boycotted it throughout history, just saying, no, we don't need to do that. That's the ego saying, you don't need to deal with the continuity fear. You'll get the results without doing that. And what are the results? Materiality. The material world, the material girl. Okay. There's a reason why they call the entertainer the material girl, right? Absolutely. That's a perfect example of what I'm talking about. Very good example. I mean, this entitlement arrogance of saying, we don't need to do the work. We're entitled to get the results without doing the work. They say we're entitled to get the results without doing any of the work, so we just boycotted any effort whatsoever because we don't need to put in any effort. We're entitled to results without any effort. This is a perversion of truth, because again, we have an extremely severe continuity problem, and until we move our comfort zone bit by bit by bit and evaporate that continuity fear, we're not going to have the true realization at all. We're not going to get the results, which is bliss, effortless bliss, bliss, not material goods. It's effortless bliss, effortless freedom. Those are the results, not all this materiality, all these toys and trinkets and stuff. That's not what we're aiming for. So they are insisting that we serve their results based on their entitlement. They say we're entitled to these results, that we're superior because we didn't make the effort, because we don't need to. And any if you don't do what we say, well, what they say is that if you don't serve us and give us what we want, you are saying that we're not entitled. See, this is the entitlement complex. It's a trap. Again, the entitlement complex says if you don't serve them and give them what they want you to give them, make them happy, that you're insisting that they're not entitled, and you're discriminating against them. So you have all these people who've been boycotting truth for so long. Now they're coming out, marching, saying, you're discriminating against us, you're discriminating, you're discriminating, because you're saying that we're not entitled. You see, and then they hook that into whatever spiritual teachings that seem to support their position. Keep in mind that Longchenpa quit was it Semjay Monastery, something around like that, the first monastery in Tibet. He was the abbot, the head abbot of the monastery, and ultimately he retired from all spiritual people, and basically and said, hey, it's full of intrigue, full of politics, full of stuff I don't like. So he was not somebody who's going to claim that somehow we're supposed to be flummoxed and by this cultural, you know, Tibetan Buddhist being used to support the notion of entitlement. If you don't do what the entitled people tell you they want you to do, that somehow you're discriminating against them, and then somehow by a vague association you're somehow rejecting, you know, Tibetans, or, you know, you're anti-spiritual, and they're able to flip it on you, you know. Whereas Longchenpa said, hey, you know, he wasn't fooled by that at all, not at all. Some of them even say he wasn't even a Buddhist at all, really. Sort of a non-Buddhist Buddhist, free of all that, you know, free of it all, free of seeing, you know, all that nonsense. So, these entitlement people are very clever, very tricky. They will use anything they can to say that they're entitled without taking care of the continuity fear at all. And if you don't give them what they tell you to give them, you're discriminating against them. You're bigoted, you're prejudiced, you're intolerant, you're sexist, you're evil. You should be punished, you should be enslaved. You're trying to enslave them, you're trying to insist that they're not entitled, which is enslavement, you know. So they've distorted the truth. It's a very bad distortion. Again, we have a very severe problem, everybody does, which is the continuity problem. And until we evaporate the continuity fear, we will not be able to accept what is inherently there for everybody without any effort, without anybody doing anything. See, without anybody doing anything whatsoever, the inherent nature of reality is blissful, uncaused, and can never be taken away, can never be changed. That's the real entitlement that we all have. Keep in mind that all the tantric techniques and stuff like that, that's just preparation, preliminary practice, as they say, to grease the overall structure so you're able to get free of the whole structure. It's part of the teaching of the tantric, Vajrayana tantric techniques of visualization. Imagine the bliss body, bodies of the Buddha, blissful bodies of the Buddha, and all this kind of stuff. But if you take it out of context, then you can, you know, what happens is you just end up using that to kind of one up people, spiritual one-upmanship. So yeah, there's a lot of these people, male and female, you know, tantric sex and all this stuff that was in the West going on, and these people then acted like they have some sort of cosmic insight into bliss and all this kind of stuff, you know. And all this has been permeating, my gosh. The way the West, you know, cherry-picked it all and spun it to support a certain types of entitlement. So, and then this is easily twisted, very easily twisted in many ways. One of them is the source of bliss or happiness is the body, sensuality. That's one of the main ways it's been twisted. And of course, then women are the givers of the sensuality. You know, they're the root, they're the ground, they're the base. And then you get this whole women's entitlement thing. It's easy to generate off of that. But they're inherently entitled without, you know. And if you don't give them what they want, you're prejudiced. There's something wrong with you. You're bad. You know, because so all of this stuff, wow, you know, it's just heavy, heavy, heavy egoic stuff going on in the world. Heavy, heavy, heavy egoic stuff. It's interesting, Mao Zedong, however you want to say it. they asked him about all the chaos in Tibet. What was it, the Kum region or something like that, that was nearest to China, the eastern part of Tibet, was in severe rebellion. You know, this was the uprising in 1959, I think, and because they confiscated all their land, they collectivized all these people. And these people had ancient traditions of land holding and all this stuff, and they just completely, you know, collectivized them. And they sent the Red Army in there, and it was this horrible situation. And they said to Mao, hey, you know, there's chaos in Tibet. And he says, great, 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 that's really great. It's very helpful. Let it get worse, let it get worse. And who's to say that that philosophy of Maoism, which really loves chaos, because it says that eventually the people will welcome our liberation of communism to come in and set everything right, you see. They'll be so miserable, and they'll welcome the liberation. And also, he says, they'll give us a perfect excuse to come in and crush them at some point. They said, let it get worse, let it get worse, let it get worse. This is his philosophy. Who's to say that philosophy has not been pushed on the world far more than we realize? That all the Tibetans, you know, fleeing from that chaos did tend to generate a lot of turmoil and chaos in the world spiritually. Where now this Maoist philosophy is coming in. People are spiritually miserable because of this entitlement complex, and it's been built up, and a lot of spiritual confusion, terrible. And now here comes the Maoist ideology on a white knight, on a white horse coming in, or a black horse coming in, and saying, I'm here to, you know, solve this chaos, solve the problems. And plus, the chaos is getting so bad, it's time to, you know, I got to come in and stop this right now. We need to stop it right now. So allow the chaos, allow the problem to get so bad that the people are praying, oh, you got to come in and do something. And so Maoism, that's what it's all about. Never let a bad crisis go to waste. Who do you think is practicing this Maoism as we speak? It's allowing crises to get worse and worse so that you can become heavy-handed about it. So the world will say, wow, yeah, there's a lot of chaos and justify it, you know. It's just, this is Maoism. This is Maoism. This is, this is the world the last 65 years or so, or, you know, 60, 70 years. Maoism has had a, you know, profound effect on the entire world. Loves chaos. I'd say the world's in spiritual chaos. It is true, absolutely true. There is a great deal of confusion that has arisen, spiritual confusion in people's minds. Terrible. Most of it has turned into justifying materiality. They've rationalized it as if somehow it's all supported, you know, the teachings to support the materiality. So what a situation, huh? How do you quiet the mind down from all this? Well, the Tibetans do. Their monasteries were destroyed, so they recreated them in India. They had a place to go. The Indian government gave them a place to go, and they recreated the various monasteries there. And the monks are now, you know, 6,000 monks or something in this monastery, like it used to be in Tibet. So, where can we go from this world? Maybe there's a place we can go. Another world will give us a place where we can go. Fleeing the Maoism, global Maoism. Keep in mind that there are a lot of people in very high political places in this world right now, including the United States, who grew up as Maoists, who had the Little Red Book. They grew up as Maoists, okay? They are Maoists, actually. Or Mao, Maoists. Maybe they're Maoists, you know, but Maoists. The ones running the show right now are Maoists, plain and simple. Ideologically, just like a goddess worshiping pagan could sit in church, but that they don't repent. But they can pretend to be model Christians or something, but they're not repentant. Just so an unrepentant Maoist can pretend to be an all-American person, but they're not. A lot of unrepentant Maoists infest the governments, bureaucracies infested with them, actually. As is Hollywood. As is the entertainment, news industry, etc., etc., etc. Because it seems to promise an entitlement to a materialistic paradise. You know, the great leap forward. The great leap forward. What was that, 59 to 61 or something like the great leap forward? The great leap into starving everybody. Here's the new way. Oh, you can't do it that way. Oh, it's too bad. You have revolutionary resistance, so that's what's causing the problem. You're not starving, you're just suffering from resistance to the revolution or something. Counter-revolutionary attitudes are causing the problem, not that there's no food. Where can we go in this world to flee from the Maoists? Where can we go? Maybe another world. I mean, we shouldn't have to be. I remember, like in the Central Asian, like what? What's the name of that? Kashgar or something. Some of the Silk Road, one of the Silk Road cities. That whole area in the Silk Road, Chinese took that over. Red cars went out there. Millions and millions of people relocated, pushed out there by China, and. Very, very much culture clash that took place there. Now, they destroyed all the mosques. That area was Muslim. And they asked the imams, what did you do? And they said, we just had to hide inside our houses for a long time, many years. Because you didn't dare pray, let anyone know you were praying whatsoever. Okay. Now, in today's world, how is it any different? I mean, you don't dare go out and talk about Jesus anywhere these days. I mean, could you imagine in your high school, like, talking about Jesus? In your school, in any school at all? How is that any different than the Maoists in Tajikistan, or, I mean, the names of the cities escape me right now, but you know what I mean? The Silk Road, Samarkand, you know, there's one. How's that any different? How's that any different than none of the Muslims being able to pray at all, you know? Talk spiritual, philosophize or anything. No, they couldn't do it anywhere. They couldn't do it in school, couldn't do it in public, anything. How is it any different right now in the United States than the Red Guards occupying that area? See, how is it any different? Those were Maoists then. How are we not under control of Maoists right now, as a matter of fact, in the United States? You can't go to any school, kindergarten, and start talking about Jesus. Carry across the school. You know what? You'd probably get a worse reaction carrying across the school than carrying a gun to school, probably. You know? They'd both be bad reactions. Probably equally bad reactions. Right? Carry a, you know, cross with Jesus, or carry, you know, a Bible to class. Can you carry a Bible to class? I'm just wondering. What if you want to check something in the Bible, you know, clarify what you're hearing the teacher saying, right? Of course. Or don't you want to check what the teacher's saying? Check it according to your, you know, holy book or something, right? Oh no, you can't do that. I don't know. Can you bring a Bible to school? Can you have a Bible in your hand? I know Santiago Castilla did in the Giants World Series parade. Actually, they called him up on stage one by one. He came out holding up a Bible. Absolute blasphemy to the Bay Area. That's great. Of course, Hunter Pence gave him a hug. That's great. But can you do that? Can you bring a Bible to school? I'm just wondering. Bring a Course in Miracles to school. So if they're teaching you lessons, you open up the Bible and you're looking and you're saying, okay, this is what the Bible says. Or this is what a Course in Miracles says. I just want to make sure that I stay clear. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. Okay, does that fit in with this basic premise? Yeah. In other words, just keep your bearings, you know, as you go to these publicly mandated schools, which Prussian school system, which mandates that everyone go to school. Just make sure that you don't lose your bearings to truth, right? But do they allow that? I don't know. Maybe they don't. Just like in Samarkand, maybe they didn't. Kashgar, is that a city? Sounds like one. Just like the Red Guards didn't allow on the Silk Road. Western expanse of China, Muslims weren't allowed to practice their religion. You couldn't bring a Quran to school, I'm sure. They're being taught, and open that up and start studying that and say, well, it says right here in the Quran, it says this and this and this. You know, they allow that? I don't think so. So how are we any different? How is the situation any different? Are we not being run by Maoists, actually? Are Maoists, some would say, that Maoists are running the whole situation? That the Maoists ran the Maoists, too? Wasn't it Mao's wife that was the most vicious of all? Cultural Revolution, all that stuff. Gang of Four, I don't know, she was pretty vicious, wasn't she? Absolutely. So maybe it's the Maoists running the Maoists, and the Maoists running the country. I mean, why can't you go to school with a shirt with Jesus on it, saying, you know, I can wear a giant shirt to school, probably, you know, giants. Why can't I wear a shirt that says, you know, Jesus on it? Just to remind me, you know. Giants reminds me, you know, that, hey, the Giants did great this year. Other people say, hey, go Giants, that's great. It reminds them, too. Why can't you wear a shirt with Jesus on it, reminding you, hey, Jesus spoke the truth here in the world. He's a savior, you know. He's fulfilling the savior function by reminding us of our freedom, that God is love. And love is freedom. Love is indeterminate, perfect indeterminate freedom. And there's no problem with God, that God isn't angry at us. You know, Jesus reminded us of the basics very well in the whole thing. Why can't we wear a shirt with that on? I mean, you see people with shirts with all sorts of graphics on them, right? You say, well, that's religion, that's religion. Isn't that religion based on truth? Isn't the purpose of schooling to school us in the truth? In facts, in facts, in facts. Now, this whole evolution creation thing is not been explained properly at all. What the Christians are getting at, they don't even understand what they're getting at, but what they're really getting at is this world is completely indeterminate. It's not even a world. God could create all this in an instant. We can create it all in an instant. Imagine it all in an instant. But we did it in a way that made it seem determinate, you see. But it's not really determinate. That's the real basis of the conflict between evolution and creationism. There's a really big conflict there. And it's because ultimately the truth is that there is no world. Nothing's ever happened. Nothing is determinate. There is no determinant. There is no causation. There is no situation. There are no circumstances. You see, that's what ultimately they're trying to get to that. That's why there's this big conflict. And of course, evolution is merely a description of like a movie. You see, but the entire movie reel, when you're seeing here, this is the thing. Okay, let's be very clear. When you're watching a movie in the movie theater, and there's a projector up in the projector booth, and the movie reel's on that projector. Now, is it not true? This very instant, that the entire movie is on that reel all at once, right? So the whole story of this movie that you're about to see play out in time is all present on that reel right now. The whole entirety is right there. And so as the film goes through the projector, you're seeing the film, and you think it's playing out on the screen like it's taking time to play out on the screen. But all of that film that's going through the projector, that's all on the reel this very instant, all of it. It's present. So we're watching this movie that seems to show us that this is all taking time, taking time, taking time. No, it's all present from the very beginning. There's nothing taking place that hasn't already taken place. In an instant. Yeah, don't try to figure it out. Keep this sort of sense of humor that prevents you from getting intellectual about it. Like we're having a good laugh together, really. Hey, that's a good way of spiritual practice. Like we're all having this good laugh together. It's all the funny, it's funny, very funny. Having a spiritual sense of humor is super important. It's actually a class of people, you know. It's a higher class than any other class in the world by far. This is a class of spiritual humor. It's a separate, it's a distinct class. Can't buy it, can you? You can't buy it. Even Bill Gates with all his money cannot buy his way into that class. Neither can Sergey Brin or anybody. Not even Carlos Slim has enough money. You cannot buy your way into this class at all. Which is why in this dream I had with Jesus, well, I was able to chat with him, and we had this great chat, laughing and humor, and it's just like smooth and easy as can be. Whereas if you don't have, if you're not of this class of spiritual humor, light, having lightened up, you know, then it's all forced. It's all awe and fear and forcedness, and you know, it doesn't work. You're not of that class. You can't. You're not of that class. Absolutely not. So this class of true spiritual humor and insight, that's historically, that's been the highest class in this world. The Brahmin class, so to speak. The true Brahmins. And then the business, the soldiers, military, governments, and then the business people, and then the sudras, I mean, they're different classes. The business people are not high class at all. Not at all. And you know, things now is that they're trying to get, you know, pretend like this high Brahmin class doesn't exist at all. This class is of genuine spiritual humor. Talking about the absurdity of it all. You know, you have to laugh. When you see, you just have to laugh. You know, it's a different sense of humor. It's kind of saying, oh yeah, I think I'm caught, but I'm not caught at all. This is funny. How funny that is, you know. So it's based on this, and you can't fake it. You cannot fake it. I always think if Jesus came back and those who would go with him, you know, people would say, well, why you? What is it? What's going on? How come Jesus likes you? Why? How come your past is ridiculous? And I don't know. Maybe Jesus likes someone or likes people to be around who get his sense of humor, you know? I think we all like to have our sense of humor appreciated. Maybe Jesus just appreciates the fact that, I, you know, I get his sense of humor to some extent. You can laugh at his jokes, you know? That's probably, you know, it's probably it, right? Who wants to be around somebody that never laughs at your jokes, doesn't get them at all, and you have to, like, explain them? They say, huh? That's weird. That's not funny, huh? Okay, what is that? That's, you know, your different classes, your different sensibilities, right? You know, business people understand that other business people's humor, and they feel comfortable, and yuck it up, you know? Athletes do. Various different classes. There's a class of spiritual humor. Not the comedic sort of stuff, you know, some people do, but no, actual inside jokes, really inside, you know, very much inside jokes. And said, oh yeah, this world, you know, yes, ain't it terrible? Oh yeah. Oh boy, yeah, there's a humor there. So again, people tend to stratify along a sense of humor. Do you get it? You know, do you get the aside? Do you get the humor? Do you get the banter? Do you get the subtlety? Do you get the sensibility? Do you get it? So birds of a feather tend to flock together. Birds of a feather flock together. So I see Jesus as smiling and laughing, you know. He's not all uptight and serious and like, you know, there's a super sobriety to him, a seriousness, sobriety to him, but also, you know, laughing and humor and like that. This silly play we're playing. Jesus said the whole problem is we forgot to laugh at ourselves. That's what, you know, we forgot to laugh at ourselves. And he says it ends, how's it all end? Jesus says, with a laugh, with a chuckle. That's how it all ends. So, and this arises, it arises within us just naturally. It's there's this spiritual chuckle at it. But Jesus is not some tortured soul on a cross, you know. He's full of spiritual humor and bliss and spiritual humor and he wants you to get his jokes, you know. He when you say something, you know, it's very funny. I can, you know, light humor, slight, you know, it's spirit. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit as God created me. How funny to think that spirit could do all this stuff to itself it can't do. How funny it is that we've tried to trick ourselves and deceive ourselves. That's funny. You know, when we see it, it's really funny. that's really funny. Humor is all inside. You have to experience the context, right? It's just this, what are you asking me for about that? Oh, that's funny, you know. Because you get it. Oh, it's so severe that, you know, how can you really need to ask? You know, so that's funny. So severe, yeah. Yeah, we've tried to kill ourselves over and over a million times. That is really funny. How funny is that? Ridiculous. It's like people go through a long ordeal and they get through and they look back and they laugh and they talk about it. Oh, well, yeah, I remember that. Oh, yeah, that was really something. Why did I do that? Oh, my gosh. What a knucklehead I was, you know. So we don't take the whole thing so seriously. Don't take it so seriously. Lightens up, lightens up, lightens up. But of course, those who don't share the humor, they do. What are you laughing for? Can you explain what was so funny? I don't get it, you know. Well, you know, that's a problem then, of course. But you should do is just be quiet, be quiet, be quiet. Get used to it, get used to it, get used to it. It's infectious, it gradually gets into you. All right, so very great. We've covered a lot of territory, been on an odyssey. Do a good job. Now back to hell, you know. Right? The hell that I just talked about in the video of living according to the way people, how they see you, as if somehow you're discriminating against them if you don't give them what they're entitled to. You're claiming they're not entitled to it, which makes you guilty, which means you're supposed to atone for your guilt by giving them what they asked you for. If you balk at it and say, "Well, I just want you to do exactly what I want you to make me happy because I'm entitled to it." No, I don't want to. What? Yeah. Oh my God. You know, oh, you don't want me to get this stuff then. You're discriminating against me. Oh, then you say, "Oh, I feel so guilty. That's terrible." And they say, "Oh, no, don't worry. You know, I'll help you get rid of that guilt. You just do what I tell you to do, and then you'll get rid of the guilt." Slavery. Slavery, 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 slavery. We live in a slave-based ideology in this world. A Maoist, entitlement, slave-based, guilt-based, fear-based ideology. Right? Absolutely we do. It's like the Empress has no clothes. You say, "Hey, wait a minute. Yeah, the Empress doesn't have any clothes." And what are you talking about? Are you saying she's not entitled to clothes? Of course she has them. She's entitled to it. So you must be thinking she's not entitled, you know. That. No, I wasn't saying that. I was just saying that this isn't... No. You're trying to convince everyone that they should not have the clothes, you know, all the finery. So you're bad. Now you've got to atone for that guilt by making sure the Empress has, oh, so many great clothes, you know. This is the trick. This is the trick. This is the trick. Trick of guilt. World runs on guilt. Oh, you're claiming I'm not entitled. It's very tricky because everybody feels they intrinsically are entitled to perfect bliss. They just don't understand. They already have it. And it's not dependent on the belief in time-space process or form or dependent causation, dependent continuity whatsoever. Not whatsoever. No, the question is, how could you be without it? What everyone is saying in this world is, "I'm entitled to be without it." Not really. Not according to God's will. All is with it. All is with it. All is entitled. Always entitled to pure bliss. Can't escape it. So we're not entitled to escape it. We are not entitled to escape it. All right, let's end it on that one. Something to consider and full stop in the now. That's it.